Hello, everybody. Welcome back to SciByte, where we explore the mysteries of the infinite universe and the tools and technology that science is using to get to the bottom of it all. I am the same as every week until I figure out somebody new to be, Jeremy. And joining me over the Skype line is the smart half of this dynamic duo, the one and only Heather.
Hi, guys.
Welcome back, Heather.
Thanks. Today, we're going to take a look at the Large Hadron Collider, what it is, what it's doing, how it's doing it, and we'll take a little bit of a peek at the science behind the curtain of the universe and some of the smallest elements and most basic interactions of the what makes everything tick.
Yeah, so we should probably do a little bit of a disclaimer here up front. We're going to be spending quite a bit of the show talking a little bit about particle physics, but that is not what the show is about.
No.
We will be covering things like quarks and leptons and other words that are not popping into my head at the moment. So we'll probably circle back on that topic at a later basis, but so you know, there will be some of that in today's show. If you're not familiar with it, I apologize. We might not be explaining any of that. If you would like to know more, if there's anything that comes up in this show and you need an explanation in order to understand what the heck it is that we're talking about, leave us a comment wherever you're watching this. I will do my best to try and clarify, or I'll make Heather do it for me because she knows more about this stuff. Or you can head over to Jupiter Colony and maybe one of the resident science nerds can clarify that for you.
Yep.
Okay, so where do we want to get started with the Large Hadron Collider?
Well, like, what is the Large Hadron Collider in a nutshell? It is the world's largest and highest energy particle accelerator. It's expected to address some of the most basic and fundamental questions of physics, advancing the understanding of the deepest laws of nature.
Now, they call it the Large Hadron Collider. Why not the largest? Mm-hmm. It is the largest, right?
I mean, yes, right now it is.
It's just kind of a cop-out name, though. When we get into talking about it, they're actually just saying what it does. It's kind of like calling a spoon a picky-uppy thingy.
Well, yeah, a picky-uppy thingy.
But that's not to dismiss just how cool the Large Hadron Collider is. In today's show, I hope that we'll be able to show you guys why it's awesome for the first thing, and for the second, why it's important. Those are really what I want to be able to cover on today's show, because I know that a lot of you folks out there watching this might have heard of it or know that people are interested in it, but not understand exactly what's going on and why we're attempting to blow up the universe, right?
Sure.
So the Large Hadron Collider is, in essence, a big circle where they smash particles together in order to study them. Now, that's a very layman's high-level explanation. We'll get into more of the details a little bit later. But what are they studying? Like, it is particle physics, right? Is there anything specific at that at a high end? Or
The subatomic particles, the most basic components of the universe, seeing the smallest elements that we can discover.
Now, when you're talking about the smallest building blocks of the universe, you're basically talking about what particle physics knows as the standard model, the series of quarks and et cetera that make up everything, at least at the smallest level that we can currently fathom.
Mm-hmm.
Not even necessarily see. That's kind of a misnomer to say that we can actually see these things, but it works in the math, and we can see some of their reactions with one another.
Mm-hmm.
The standard model is basically, correct me if I'm wrong, Heather, but we don't actually have a complete standard model. Like, not everything on the standard model is 100% proven.
No,
correct?
It doesn't all work out, but it works for a lot of things.
Now, but that's one of the things that the LHC is trying to get to the bottom of, right?
Mm-hmm.
If not to prove this, that the standard model is correct, to prove it's wrong, one way or the other.
To disprove it and to let us go down a branch of physics and figure out this is the path that we're going to go down. And this is where, you know, the more we find out, the more we are confused. So let's get the answers to those confusions.
Now, a part of the standard model is four different forces. I think they're generally termed forces. They're kind of the fundamental interactions, the ways that these tiny little particles interact with one another and cause other things to interact.
Yeah, not only the tiny little particles, but how everything in the universe, from galaxies to the most smallest of basic particles that we can think of, all interact in one of four ways.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the strongest interaction is called the strong force, the strong nuclear force. This force is sort of carried along by something called gluons. And I'm going to speak about a couple of different elements that we'll get to in a few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
They act on quarks and act as the glue that sort of holds these tiny little things together.
Well, these must have been some of the first things that they discovered, so they gave them really simple names. Strong force, gluons.
Gluons. These quarks are the things inside protons and neutrons, what they're made of. So it's holding them together. It's the strongest force. It's about 100 times stronger than the next weakest force. But it only has a range of about the size of a proton. So it works on the incredibly small scale, but it's incredibly strong.
Ah, I see. So, but it's strong enough to hold these fundamental particles in contact with another to form, to build protons, electrons.
To build protons and neutrons
which
and
then make
other
up atoms, which then make up molecules.
Yep,
which,
and
blah,
atoms
blah, blah.
Themselves mm-hmm. are held together by electromagnetism, the electromagnetic force. Its force carrier is a photon. So it acts on charged particles. It's responsible for the propagation of light. It gives magnets the ability to pick up a paperclip.
Mm-hmm.
The next weakest fundamental interaction of nature is the weak force. It is where we exchange particles with bosons and explains energy production of the sun, radioactive beta decay. And after that, we have gravity. Gravity is actually the weakest of the four fundamental forces.
Well, it's the weakest, and yet it's the one that we as humans interact the greatest with. I mean, we don't necessarily interact with the strong or weak forces. We see electromagnetism in, like, powering our devices and technology and stuff like that, but we don't directly interact with anything but gravity, and it's the weakest of the fundamental interactions of the universe.
That is correct.
That's interesting to think about. Now, but you were saying that... Okay, so the strong nuclear force, they're carried by gluons. Then we've got photons doing electromagnetism. Bosons do the weak force. What does gravity then? What controls gravity?
Well, theoretically, the gravitron, but it is the one that we have not actually seen. Yeah, it's a theoretical answer. It's believed that since the other three all have some sort of force carrier particle, that gravity should have one too. We just haven't seen the gravitron. We haven't seen any evidence of it indirectly or directly.
So this is one of the things that the LHC is attempting to get to the bottom of, is actually discovering, seeing a firsthand evidence of the existence of a graviton.
Graviton or something else that could carry this gravitational force of why things
are
interact the way they do.
Yeah. Now, what happens if they don't? Or, well, I guess that proves that it doesn't exist if eventually they don't. But how long do they work without finding something before they go, well, that was wrong? I guess that's science for you, isn't it?
Yeah. You just kind of go until you're like, well, if you get enough data, then you can graph it out. You can map it out and say, you know what? It's really apparent that this is not happening, that we haven't seen it, that if it does happen, it's happening so little of the time, it can't be a fundamental force of nature.
Right.
If we're not seeing evidence of it at all, now it hasn't been going on for that long, but we're still looking for it. So it's kind of a wait and see kind of a thing. But thinking about all these fundamental interactions kind of poses an interesting thought that if the electron had a different mass, then the electromagnetic force in atoms would be different. It would be of a different size. Therefore, atoms would be a different size, and all of matter would be a different size.
At a very fundamental, like the basic building blocks of the universe would be a different size. It's kind of like if you were using Duplo blocks instead of Legos to build everything.
Yeah, and it's that thought of, you know, everyone hears, you know, an atom is 99% empty, but it's these kind of electromagnetic forces that hold them at a certain distance from each other. You can't get any closer than that. So it's, if that force was bigger, then...
Now, I'm kind of curious. The Large Hadron Collider primarily is looking at these tiny little force carriers and the other quarks that make up matter. But I'm just curious, from a layman's point of view, how long have we known about the existence of quarks to a degree that we could actually prove that there was something smaller than the atomic scale?
Well, it's happened in the last century. Now, we'll kind of roll it back a little. You start off thinking at the most basic elements of the universe, and at some point in your life, the most basic element of the universe is the atom. You know, the helium, iron, you know, 118 elements. You see the periodic table and you think, that is the basics of the universe.
Right. That's what makes up the entire universe right there, and we're done, right?
Yeah. But... all of, if you think about it, a little, it can simplify it quite a bit by thinking all of those are created by electrons, protons, and neutrons in a different mix.
You know, so at some point, maybe we need to tell people how to read the periodic table. I just thought that might make a decent sci-bite topic sometime.
Could be.
In a nutshell, those little numbers that you see in the corners of the boxes, those are indicators of the number of protons, electrons, neutrons, other things like that.
The entire layout of the periodic table tells you something, where it is on the chart.
Right. Okay, well, maybe we'll talk about that some other time. But okay. Yeah, but you're right, absolutely. Every one of those items on the periodic table, obviously, mm-hmm. is made up of these other fundamental building blocks.
Yeah, so we thought, great, we've got the entire universe down to three things. Except at the beginning of the 20th century, we started seeing all sorts of other particles from cosmic rays, these energetic charged subatomic particles flying in space.
We thought we had it, and then we looked into space.
And then they hit, you know, atoms in our atmosphere, and we started seeing all these other strange, weird particles. And we thought, oh, that's interesting. So we'll add another one. And they started getting so many different names to these things. They started running out of, like, symbols and names for all these different things. So, like, all right, we need to get some organization to this. This is just getting way too crazy.
And that's kind of where the standard model was born from, was to kind of organize all of these new tiny subatomic particles.
Yep. So they started organizing them by charge, which way they spin, mm-hmm. by mass, how long they lasted until they decayed into simpler particles.
Now, as I said at the beginning of the episode here, we probably don't want to go too far into this. Let's kind of roll it back a second here.
Okay.
Back to the collider that's actually mm-hmm. smashing and making these things and studying them. The name, again, because this is mm-hmm. something that has always kind of interested me, kind of confused me, actually. I never knew that there was such a thing as a hadron, honestly.
Yes.
I've just kind of took it for granted for a long time that I thought the Large Hadron Collider was named after somebody until I thought about it and realized that that would indicate that they were colliding people named Hadron together.
Yeah, and
that
see what happens?
Make much sense.
No.
So what's a hadron? Tell me what this is.
A hadron is made up of quarks. Including, you know, protons and neutrons. They're just, it's like a generic name for a group of composite particles. There are many theorized types of hadrons. Most of them only exist very briefly in time. The best known ones are protons and neutrons.
So it basically indicates that in the collider, they're colliding. Mm-hmm. I believe it's primarily protons that they're smashing together.
Generally, the type of hadrons used inside the collider are lead ions. Those are lead atoms stripped of their electrons. That's mostly where they come from.
And again, the reason that they're doing this is because the standard model, as we were talking mm-hmm. about earlier, is incomplete. It doesn't It doesn't explain the whole universe, even if it is complete. Am I off base on that? I mean, I'm not a particle physicist, so...
You know, some people have heard of the Higgs boson theory.
Yeah.
You know, those Higgs bosons to sort of substitute. So instead of gravitons, it would be, like, Higgs boson field would be some, like, sticky tape everywhere. And some particles don't interact with it, and some really stick to it, so it kind of slows some things down really much. A lot.
Okay,
I had heard of this, but
I didn't realize that Higgs boson was an alternative to a gravitational theory.
Sort of. It's not just a straightforward thing, but it's kind of the simplified way to kind of look at it.
But, and that might have come about, that whole theory may have come about, correct me if I'm wrong, because we can't locate the graviton. Because we can't find that. So now we're looking for something else that to date we have not been able to find.
True.
But that's one of the top experiments that you hear about when, if you watch Big Bang Theory on television and stuff like that, when they talk about the Large Hadron Collider, it tends to be in reference to the Higgs bosons and stuff like that. So that's kind of a hot topic with science right now, right?
Yes, it is. It's figuring out why things move faster or slower, what gives them, you know, their apparent weight, how gravity works. It's one of those really fundamental things that take for granted. You drop your glass and it falls. Getting that to work out is kind of a little tricksy, and getting to figure out why it works that way.
But the fun part of trying to figure out why it works that way is that you get to use things like the Large Hadron Collider. I mean, who doesn't love throwing them together at each other at almost the speed of light for the sake of science, right?
There you go.
So let's get into a little bit about what the Large Hadron Collider can do, because the name gives away a lot of it. You take hadrons and you collide them, largely, I guess.
the collider itself is very large.
Right, and people have seen pictures of the Large Hadron Collider, I'm sure. You know that it takes up, well, first of all, it's not on the surface, but there is kind of an indicator of where it is when you see pictures from the sky. It's huge. It's huge. I mean, they should have called it the Huge Hadron Collider, because it's really, really freaking big. The circumference here is 17 miles. Mm-hmm. around that sucker. That's about 27 kilometers. I have a question. Why is it underground? Wouldn't it have been easier to build this thing on the surface if you could find a place flat enough? like
yes,
Kansas.
And well, sure. One, it was cheaper to excavate a tunnel underground than to purchase the surface land. It also minimized the impact to the environment, which they were kind of happy about. And where it is built actually has this green sandstone layer of ground that isn't very stable. It's like building out of bedrock. They had to go down. They needed to find something as stable as they could find. It didn't impact the environment. They didn't have to buy the surface land itself. Mm-hmm. So it made sense to make it underground.
Now, also, I've heard in regards to some other science experiments and stuff that they do their work way underground when they're working with particle physics. Is that like, does it block radiation or anything like that? Is that also why they would be doing this under the surface instead of on it?
Well, yeah, the Earth's crust will block some of the radiation that is there that could make it to the surface of the Earth. So it helps mitigate that as well.
Okay, I have one more question about being underground, and I'm not sure if you can answer this. Why in all of the videos that I see at the Large Hadron Collider, are they wearing a hard hat? I mean, seriously, if something goes down at the Large Hadron Collider, a hard hat, what are the odds that a hard hat's going to really help you? I mean, seriously.
I think that's mostly because there's people higher than you and lower than you. And anytime you're dealing with a scaffolding issue.
Oh, you're worried about them dropping tools on your head and stuff
Yeah, you're
like
more
that.
Worried about them dropping a wrench on your head.
Ah, okay.
You know, no. If something goes down that badly.
They just look goofy in hard hats. That's all I'm saying. Now, we can picture 17 miles in circumference. That's easy enough for the brain to wrap its head around. But some of the other, the stats of the Large Hadron Collider start to get really astronomical when you start talking about the inner core of the technology at work here. Yeah. The amount of power that it uses, the temperatures that we're talking. Like, I was just asking during one of our outtakes that might make it into the end of the show, if I remember to put it in, that how do you make the tube itself empty enough so that when you're shooting around these tiny, tiny, infinitesimally small little hadrons, can you guarantee that they don't hit anything on the way? Mm-hmm. And you told me, I, kind of offhandedly, I don't think that you were actually thinking about the fact that you were just, it's cold, dummy. That's the thing, though. And I don't think that this gets brought up very much, but the Large Hadron Collider is like the world's largest refrigerator, isn't it?
1/8 of the refrigerant capacity of the Hadron Collider would be the largest refrigeration capacity.
So it's more than 8 times over the largest refrigerator in the world. And it can drop the temperature of that vacuum inside their collider tube to, I got it here somewhere. Do you have it handy?
It operates at temperatures even lower than outer space at about 1.9 Kelvin.
And that, again, is so that the whatever tiny little particles are inside there that are not intended to be collided with each other will hold still.
Yeah.
So they don't get in the way of the experiment.
Sort of freezing things in place, sucking all that you can out, bringing you down to a pressure that is 10 times less than the surface of the moon.
Oh, that's...
So that you can have as empty a space as possible so you can shoot these beams around.
Now, another interesting note is that even though they're operating at these incredibly cold temperatures, so much colder than the vacuum of space, the actual temperatures generated by this thing are more than 100,000 times hotter than the heart of the sun at the point where those two hadrons actually collide.
That is correct.
That actually leads me to wonder, isn't this thing dangerous? I mean, most of us have probably seen that website, has the LHC destroyed the world? I don't know if that site's still around anymore, but it was just in big bold letters, it says no, because if they're wrong, who's going to check?
The website won't be there, we won't be there.
It was a very real concern, at least it seemed to be, at the time when they were actually generating or developing the Large Hadron Collider, before they had turned it on. There was a significant, I don't know how many people were worried about this in the scientific communities, but there were a lot of, especially in the media, that were like, if they turn this on, it's going to cause a black hole and rip apart the universe. This is the end of humanity as we know it, and science is bringing us to our doom. But... I've already read ahead.
Not quite as dangerous as we'd like to think.
Yeah, spoilers, people here. I've already read some of our show notes here, and it's not as dangerous as you might think. Even though those temperatures are so hot. Actually, you know what? We'll get to that in a little bit, because there's more details of the actual collider itself that I want to talk about. But don't freak out. This thing is awesome, but it's not going to hurt anybody. Well, at least the chances of it doing so are incredibly small.
Yeah, better chance that somebody's going to drop a wrench and it's going to fall on somebody's head below.
Which is why they wear hard hats. I get it now. It's science. Now, the Large Hadron Collider itself, mm-hmm. it looks like a circle, but I yes. think part of that is because it's so big.
Yes, because it's not actually a circle.
Right.
But it's when you not get, a perfect circle.
Let's see. It's made of 8 arcs and 8 mm-hmm. straight intersections. So
that's correct.
Really, that's not a circle at all. More than half of it is straight, or exactly half of it.
Well, I don't know what percentage of each of those, off the top of my head, what percentage each of those represent. But it mm-hmm. makes it also, if you think about it, it makes more sense to have all the detectors and the sensors and stuff in a nice little straight section.
Yes, it does.
So you're not looking around a corner.
You got enough issues to deal with just being on this planet while you're trying to do science. You know,
looking at the teeniest, tiniest particles of the universe, give yourself a break.
Make part of the pipe straight. Getting back to the fact that it's under the crust, you know, the guys that run these experiments that have to tune the beams so that they mm-hmm. interact at the right point and aim 2 beams of hadrons at one another, they have to account for things like tidal pressure on the Earth's crust. We're talking very small scales for how much impact the moon has on us. But the guys that run these things, they have to continuously check the moon to re-aim there.
Yeah.
So, yes, give them a break. Put some straight sections in there, absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, how do they actually shoot the things around? I know the answer to this. How do they actually shoot the hadrons around?
Now, part of that acceleration is electrical pulses, magnets to help kind of guide these things. But mm-hmm. in order to bend them around the arcs, you need some really powerful magnets to sort of guide the particles along the curve.
How powerful are we talking here on these magnets?
Well, I mean, there's over 9,000 magnets.
What, 9,000? There's no way that could be right.
And it's more tonnage than the Eiffel Tower.
Whoa. Buried under a little circle.
I'm buried under a big circle made up of, that's just the magnets part.
Right.
These magnets aren't just big pieces of metal like you think, you know, the type that you get that you put on your refrigerator.
They're not the big horseshoe type that you see in the cartoons either, right?
No. These are superconducting electromagnets, which means they're strands of tubing that get wrapped around in circles. And then if you pass electricity through that, it sort of creates a magnetic field.
Now, you've got some stats on these babies in our show notes that I am just fascinated with. Let me shout some of these out to you guys. These, mm-hmm. So they're magnetic coils. They're wound from cable made up of 36 individual twisted strands, mm-hmm. each one of these coils. These strands are made up of somewhere between 6 and 9,000.
What, 9,000? There's no way that can be right.
Individual filaments that are coiled together to make that strand, which is then makes the coil. So it's kind of analogous to actual matter. We've got coils made up of strands, made up of filaments, made up of molecules and atoms and quarks, all the way as far as we go. But the total strands that mm-hmm. they use in the LHC would circle the Earth 6 times at its equator, at its largest diameter. That is a whole lot of these things. So they coil all of those together into the bigger magnetic coils.
Mm-hmm.
The mind-boggling fact, though, that we have in here, the individual filaments, that's the one that, mm-hmm. remember, there's 6 to 9,000 of those filaments that make up each of those individual strands that could wrap around the planet. The total filaments, if unraveled and laid end to end, could stretch to the sun and back 6 times.
And then with the leftovers, you could travel to the moon and back 150 times.
You know, if you wanted to, after going to the sun and back 6 times, if you wanted to. So what's the actual length of that? Who cares? Millions and millions and millions of miles of magnetic filament that's used to bend the beams.
Yeah,
really?
To help accelerate and bend the beams.
Are the magnets used in the acceleration process as well, or is that something separate?
So they start off with, you know, protons and neutrons from either hydrogen or lead ions or whatever, mm-hmm. and they feed them into various circles. They don't just feed straight into the Large Hadron Collider circle. There's smaller ones that you can sort of step up your speed, get faster and faster with each circle or circumference.
You never see those in their pictures and things like that. Are they just little tiny things, or
They're a lot smaller. Some of the smallest portions are, you know, less than a percentage of the size of the Large Hadron Collider.
Less than 1%.
less than 1% or 2% the size. So they're very small. Sometimes when you see a video, you'll see it zoom out and you'll see a couple of small little circles, and then you'll zoom out and see the Large Hadron, the main area. So those small little things are part of the acceleration process. And through that acceleration process, the various steps, they use magnets and electromagnets to try to help speed it up through pulsations, through, you bend it, squeeze them together, and shoot them off into the next section.
Now, I have a question, because we're dealing with things flying around at nearly the speed of light. We're talking like more than 90%, even at their slowest point on the Large Hadron, more than 90% of the speed of light.
Mm-hmm.
At points during this, 99.9% of the speed of light at by the time that they collide. Wow. But when we're talking about relativistic speeds, you also have to take into consideration energy to mass conversions and things like that. Even if you're dealing with something tiny, doesn't it take just an unfathomable amount of energy to continue speeding that up? And at some point, doesn't it start spilling backwards, kind of?
Sort of, yeah. At a certain point, you can't speed it up any faster. So essentially, you're dumping more energy in it to increase the mass of these things. The protons end up about 7,000 times heavier than they were at resting, when they were at rest.
Wow, and that's just from the amount of energy that's fed into them while they're being sped up around these.
Yeah, because they can't get any faster, so mass has to increase.
Now, when you increase the mass of something like this, you're not actually increasing the size or the prevalence of the amount of quarks, are you? Like, does that make more to blow up?
No, not really. It's just sort of that energy equals mass times acceleration thing. Your acceleration hits a cap. You can't go any faster, but you keep dumping energy into it. So you're sort of making them heavier. It's that, you know, the problem with you can't travel the speed of light because your spaceship gets heavier and heavier.
But
you're not
making
a bigger
heavier
spaceship. You're just sort of making it heavier.
Have more of an impact on space.
Yes.
Now, so that doesn't have an impact on the actual outcome of the results, other than the fact that they're still trying to push it to this relativistic speed.
Yeah, you're pushing it to the limit so that you can blast them together with as much energy as possible, so that they break down into these simpler elements that you can then try to take a peek at and look at.
Now, when we're talking about subatomic particles and these little tiny hadrons, these little tiny hadrons that are really, guys, tiny, even at 7,000 times their base resting mass, there is so much information contained within these when they blow them. You guys have probably seen the pictures of those fun little spirals with the lines and the twisty things. Those are some of the data that comes out of these explosions. I don't know how to read them. I would never even fathom how to begin with all of that. But
I can give you a simple explanation.
Yeah, please do.
The more straight the line is for a particle, the more massive it is, because they're in a magnetic field. So which way they curve indicates their charge. And depending on how fast they're accelerating, means they're just speeding out of there. They don't have a lot of time to curve. Now, if they're heavy or slow, then they're going to have more time to curve, and you'll see them spiral. So the spirally things are things that are traveling slower or heavier. And which way the spiral goes is what kind of charge they have.
So when the scientists at the LHC are looking at those pictures of things exploding, and if they're looking specifically for a graviton, they have theories about how it should look if it shows up? Or a Higgs boson, or whatever it is that they're looking for?
Well, kind of yes and no at the same time. They know how it should interact with other particles. They may not be able to see them directly. Maybe able to see it indirectly. I mean, you can't see quarks directly per se. You see them indirectly, see how they interact with everything, and can kind of define things in that way.
So I was oversimplifying it, me and my non-scientificness. But each of those pictures, those explodey things, are pictures of a collision.
Yes.
How many collisions do they actually do when they're running their experiments? Is there like a number of collisions per second that we can lay on the people?
Yeah, they have 150 million sensors delivering 40 million times a second, so that they can catch about 100 collisions a second of data.
100 of those collisions per second when they're speeding their hadrons around the circles. Per second.
Yes.
And then they have to take all, how much, that must be a phenomenal amount of data that they're capturing.
Oh, yes. Well, it's about 100 collisions of interest. The sampling rate capacity is even higher. They could look it up to 600 million collisions a second.
What? You can't do that.
Well, they can.
Well, that would take up like every hard drive in the planet in like the half a minute.
It's about, from the four main experiments, it's about 15 million gigabytes a year.
Whoa.
That would fill up about 100,000 dual-layer DVDs every year.
That's, do they keep that data? I guess they must keep a good amount of it.
Well, they keep everything of interest, and they spread it about so that everyone can see. Wow. And then everyone just goes and tries to get the data of interest to them.
Well, I guess that's what the internet's for, right? You just put that up there, and Wikipedia takes care of it all for you. Okay, so obviously the technical specs of the LHC are phenomenal. This is, I think, without a doubt, I think probably anybody watching this is going to agree, this is a marvel of modern engineering. This is absolutely the pinnacle of engineering and science coming together. The capabilities of the LHC are seriously out of this world. Just, I don't know why we don't have spaceships yet. Let's be honest. But let's talk, okay, I mentioned it earlier. I touched on it a little bit about how there was certain people that thought the LHC was extremely dangerous, and that kind of gave some negative press when it was starting to be built. Before we start talking about the specifics of how dangerous it is or isn't, and again, spoilers, it isn't, let's talk a little bit about the amount of energy that is produced by this. And when we talk about this, keep in mind the incredibly small scale, and some of the numbers that we'll be mentioning here, I'll try to reflect that to you, but it's something you kind of got to just got to get on board and wrap your brain around this, people, because this is crazy stuff. So let's talk a little bit about when we're talking about colliding hadrons. Now keep in mind that this is always compared to the Big Bang. Like this is they're talking about smashing things together at 99.9999% of the speed of light. Going in opposite directions. That should release a phenomenal amount of energy, right?
Yes.
Just how much energy is released by that explosion, that tiny little explosion?
Now, the energy density is about the same, but the total amount of energy really isn't.
So when you say energy density is similar to the Big Bang, but we're talking about so little matter compared to the actual explosion, theoretical explosion of the universe, there's not much energy?
Each proton flying around the Large Hadron Collider only has enough energy to light a 60-watt light bulb for about a little over 18 and a half nanoseconds.
Nanoseconds, yeah. And just to paint a clearer picture to y'all watching along, I'm going to type out 18 and a half nanoseconds right here on the final version. Yeah, that's the correct amount of zeros.
Yep.
It's not much at all. In fact, there's another note here in our show notes that say that I could actually generate more electricity than that by clapping my hands.
Like, yes, that is
right
correct.
Now, if I just...
Yep. That was
just,
more... That
I just
was
did
more
than the Large Hadron Collider.
Yep, because it's not very dense. I mean, it's spread out all over your hand.
Right.
I mean, they're throwing together things that are smaller than atoms. So it's a very, very small amount of space for all this energy to go to.
Now, there's also another note here in our show notes that say that one tera electron volt is about the same energy as a flying mosquito.
That's correct.
So,
so it's seven times the energy of a flying mosquito.
Which, to be fair, when you're talking about matter smaller than an atom, that's pretty darn impressive. But when you're talking about, is it going to blow up the planet?
Not so impressive.
In fact, that's probably a good segue to start talking about just how dangerous, even theoretical. Let's if we can, let's start throwing out some worst case scenarios here when we start talking about this, because really, it's not that much to worry about, but wear your hard hat nonetheless. Yeah. For example, you actually mentioned earlier in this show that the one of the ways that we as humans started to discover the existence of quarks was by observing cosmic rays.
That's correct.
Cosmic rays hit the planet all the time. And we just talked about the sun last week, and that thing is bombarding us constantly with radiation and other forms of cosmic rays that probably are actually more dangerous than the LHC, if you think about it, right?
Yeah, its energy is much larger than the LHC is putting out, and it's been bombarding the Earth, Jupiter, the sun, all these different locations since their formation, and not really any effect that we've been able to see. So the small, tiny amounts that the LHC is putting out, nowhere near as much as that, probably not going to do anything.
Even if, like, the containment broke down and all of a sudden an explosion got out. All right, not really anything to worry about, right?
No, if the container broke down, it meant some of the magnets went down, and then instead of the beams hitting each other, they just hit a wall, which right. would produce some particles that they just wouldn't get to see.
They just have to break out the dustpan if they could find the explosion. Now, okay, so some of the other concerns that, the media brought up is like mm-hmm. many Big Bangs. Are we creating yeah. universes? Are we playing God? Are we Big Banging in the palm of our hands? Well, tell me about the comparison there. I mean, that's way
no,
off base.
No, the incredibly small scale. Right. The energy concentration, like I said before, does represent sort of the energy produced at the Big Bang. Mm-hmm. But the total energy is just so incredibly small that it's just not enough to do anything.
Now, what about black holes? Mm-hmm. This is probably the one that got the most media attention is because we're yep. dealing with relativistic speeds and matter and everything like mm-hmm. that. Could we punch a hole in the universe with the Large Hadron Collider? Could we create a black hole?
Yeah, when we look out and we see these black holes in the center of galaxies, you know, mm-hmm. sucking up stars, these are things that were the mass of a star. Literally, they're created by a star collapsing.
Right.
Big stars collapsing.
Yeah, very, very large stars. Your yeah, average star is probably not going to ever become a black hole.
It can't. And it has probably, to be certain than a
You know what? We should talk about black holes one day on SciBite.
Sure.
It goes on the list. So, but the amount of mass in
that
a
we're
hadron.
Talking about, if it created a black hole, would be so microscopic that it couldn't interact with surrounding matter at all. In fact, theories say that, you know, even if we created one of these microscopic black holes, they would only exist for a fleeting few moments before they would just evaporate upon themselves and disappear.
Because they can't interact with the matter around it, so
they can't
sustain
do
themselves. And, but you know what? If we ever did manage that would be awesome. I really think it would.
Oh no.
Now, what about like radiation? I mean, anytime you deal with anything that's studying, that's using a lot of magnets and everything, mm-hmm. people are going to worry about radiation effects.
Sure, what kind of threat does it pose to the local population?
Right, exactly.
Now, of course, they're going to do studies on this, and the studies have shown that the radioactivity released into the air contributes to an air dosage of the public. About 10 years worth of that is equal to one round trip from Europe to Los Angeles.
Oh. So again, the scales are just way off.
Oh yeah, it's about 240 times less than your average year in Switzerland. Very low. It's not a lot of threat that poses to the public.
So we think. No, the Large Hadron Collider is not going to and has not destroyed the world. I can't envision any way that it possibly could. In fact, let's get into some of the things that they're actually studying.
Sure.
Using the Large Hadron Collider to smash the hadrons into one another. Mm-hmm. What are some of the things that they're trying to figure out? And if you guys watched our Sun episode last night, you know that science loves acronyms. So let's talk about ALICE.
ALICE literally is a Large Ion Collider Experiment.
Are you kidding me?
That is what it stands for.
That is what ALICE, they gave this thing, oh my goodness. God, they are suckers for a good acronym.
Scientist is a good sucker for an acronym.
Okay, so what is ALICE? Okay, a large ion collider experiment looking
yes.
at.
Yes. It specializes in analyzing lead ion collisions. They study try to study the properties of quark gluon plasmas. You know, when quarks and gluons are no longer confined by hadrons. You know, mm-hmm. these crazy scenarios that probably existed just after the Big Bang. So it's kind of start of the universe type stuff.
And just as a reminder, gluons are the things that are the strong nuclear force, right?
That is correct. Gluons are the force carrier for the strong nuclear force.
Okay, so the next experiment that we'll cover very briefly is called mm-hmm. ATLAS. I actually couldn't find an explanation of what ATLAS stands for. Could you find it anywhere?
No, I couldn't really find something that was very straightforward.
It might be in a foreign language or something. So
yeah.
What are they looking at there at ATLAS?
It's more a general purpose detector trying to cover the widest range of physics possible. It's the largest volume collider detector ever constructed. Mm. It searches from everything from the Higgs bosons to supersymmetry to extra dimensions.
Ooh, extra dimensions?
It's looking at the widest possibility of things that it can look for.
So this is the one most likely to destroy us.
It will see when we're destroyed.
Okay,
it will see what causes our destruction.
Okay, well, thank you, ATLAS. Now, how about, this one isn't a very good name. Did they run out of good names? CMS, The compact muon solenoid.
It was built around a huge superconducting solenoid that can generate magnetic fields about 100,000 times that the Earth can create.
Wow.
It's another sort of general purpose detector, kind of like Atlas.
100,000 times stronger than the magnetic field of the Earth. I think we should be lucky that they're concentrating on scales so small.
Yes. Well, that's really the only place that we can do things that much stronger.
So far. Okay, so then there's just a couple that are just called the Large Hadron Collider.
LHCb, Large Hadron Collider, Beauty.
What does Beauty stand for?
For some reason.
We don't even know why it's called Beauty? Ah, it's a beauty.
It is a beauty. But it's studying the asymmetry between matter and antimatter. This thing is using a series of sub-detectors to detect certain types of particles and antimatter and things like that.
Oh, okay. Well, we did touch on antimatter in a previous thing. So this is probably something that those dudes at CERN are using to help them out with their experiments.
That's
theoretically
correct.
Okay. And the Large Hadron Collider Forward.
Yep. These are some of the smaller experiments going on. Those were the four major ones. Mm-hmm. The Large Hadron Collider Forward is experiments measure particles produced close in the direction of the beams, sort of testing models to estimate the energy of ultra-high energy cosmic rays.
Oh, okay. Cosmic rays. Those could come in handy. Okay. One last one that's also another one of the smaller ones. And finally, we get another good acronym. Thank heavens. TOTEM.
The Total Elastic and Diffractive Cross-Sectional Measurement.
Are you kidding me?
That's its name.
They just made that up. What's TOTEM doing out there?
It's measuring the effective size and cross-section of a proton. It detects particles produced really close to the LHC beams.
This is, there's so much stuff going on there, though, not only at LHC, but at CERN, where the LHC is attached to. Mm-hmm. We have tons of extra information in our show notes. And if you want to learn more about any of these, Atlas or Alice, or any of these other ones going on, we actually skipped over a whole bunch of our show notes because I can tell Mars is interested in this subject. We have a big show doc for you guys. But yes, tons of extra links. Mm-hmm. There's extra media, CERN TV. They have their own television station,
they
apparently.
Do. On YouTube.
Great. Awesome. Well, I know you guys like video because you're watching us. And a Facebook page for the Large Hadron Collider. What does he just post? Well, I went around in circles again. I mean, I know that when we're talking about the Large Hadron Collider, it is difficult to separate the technology from the science. And I hope that we didn't just glaze over too much of what's actually going on there, because I did want to talk more about the tech this time around. Probably on a future show, we'll dig a little more into like the standard model of particle physics and stuff like that. So, and probably have to reference back to the Large Hadron Collider and Atlas and Alice and things like that. But that won't be next week. So next week, I've decided to steer us back into the heavens, but not off the planet. We're going to be talking about another one that came up when we were talking about antimatter, as a matter of fact. anyway, sorry, distracted. We were going to be talking about lightning next week, the science of lightning. That's going to include things like, you know, the basic sheet lightning and streak lightning and heat lightning and snow lightning, I guess. I don't know. I haven't done my research yet, so I don't know what all is out there. But lightning is awesome.
Yes.
And pretty.
Yes.
And you know from personal experience over the last couple of weeks, loud as heck.
Yes.
There's been some storms there in your region.
Yes,
so first-hand
been.
Knowledge. So that'll be on next week's show. Mm-hmm. And until then, everybody, if you would like to reach us, you can always leave a comment wherever it is that you're watching this. We do read them. Unfortunately, our schedules are such that we don't get a chance to respond to most of them. If you would like a better chance of getting a response, you need to email us. That's probably the best way to do this. Am I right?
That is right. Email us at scibyte@jupiterbroadcasting.com.
And if you just don't want to load up your email program, you can also surf on over to Twitter and follow me at JBJeremy.
Or me at JB_MarsBase.
Absolutely. And we've also got Facebook.com/JupiterBroadcasting and, as I said earlier, JupiterColony.com, which is our forum where you can talk to us and you can talk to other science geeks and just have a good time with it. If you have any interest and information about lightning in particular for next week's show, I'd love to hear about that because it saved me some time on the research, right? All right, everybody. Well, until next week, we hope you've had fun here on SciByte, and we'll see you then. We'll be right back.
to the east side.
Hey, I'm singing. To the east side.
Science is sad.
Now, but you were saying that, what were you saying?
hold on.
Push! Here it comes. There we
Yay!
Go.
Yay! I did it.
Don't ruin science!
So, mass has to increase.
Well, that makes no sense at all.